keep it here. We were talking about making a film, on the film. Be good, that. You know, just like you were part of it, viewers. You know, you're here with us. What do you think we should do? Tell us. How do you make a fucking movie, man?
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of Great Britain. Bonsoir Paris. Guten Abend München. Hola España. Ciao Roma.
Good evening, New York.
Konnichiwa Tokyo.
Chez du Brasil.
People of Canada.
Hello, Netherlands.
Milano, Nippon,
people of Boston,
people of Florida,
Georgia,
San Francisco,
Chicago,
Detroit,
Detroit,
Cincinnati.
When I was 40, everyone said life begins at 40, so I looked around for a couple of days and nothing appeared to begin. So I thought, oh, well, I'd better start some stuff. So I started, like, jogging a little bit, you know, because I'd never done that before. But that might be a good idea, and that was good fun. I enjoyed that. Nothing serious, but a little bit. And then I thought, well, I'd love to paint. You know, I've always loved drawing. And at school, I did get a little art prize, but there were never anything big. But I did love to do it, always loved to doodle and fiddle around. But I always had this big block in my head that it was those people that painted and not us. It's like they ride horses, we don't.
I tell you, actually, the most fun about this for me was playing with the charcoal. I'd draw the charcoal away from the line, see? And you get that, and yeah. Try and leave the line. So it still was a...
So you got both?
Yeah. You still pull it away here.
Yeah.
So this is all just playing with this little theory I started to get. And you see this kind of bird on the top?
Oh, yeah.
Like a little hawk screaming in the sky.
Yeah, screaming, yeah.
Well, this is a representation of a tree.
Yeah.
There's another little one there. But then this owl on an oar.
It's owl, it's
a very golden owl.
Yeah.
Like, he's sort of...
Like my angel.
Yeah. And then this little guy, so it almost reminds me of a cross between a bishop and a punk. So they're almost like, his robes are almost, you know, religious, regal robes somehow. Yeah. But then he's, and he looks a bit bishopry. But then, got this slightly wild hairdo.
Some days I look at you with eyes that shine. Some days I don't believe that you are mine.
It gives me a very similar thing to what music does. It's sort of, it's a consolation. And I just love it. I just love to do it.
Some days I look. Some days I look into your soul. Sometimes I laugh to think how young we were. Sometimes it's hard to know which way to turn.
She's like John in that kind of way, you know, she's like, go on, do it, go on, you know, try it, have a go. She's been strength for a long time, you know. We've married, what now, coming up for 28 years, you know, so, yeah, she's my baby. She comes out at night, taking me by surprise. Yeah, she's my girl.
We don't need anybody else to tell us what is real inside. Each one of us is love and we know how it feels.
It's like wild pigs in these woods. And some people accuse us of harbouring killer pigs. Just that we don't shoot them anyway. But you'll see their tracks.
Quite harmless, really, but we've never seen them.
You know, we know everything's bigger in America, like England's a little bit smaller, perhaps, but that is our giant redwood. give him time. Give him time. That is a Sequoia giganticum. Come back here in 200 years, and it should be right shooting up by then.
I like the idea of just this sort of, you know, out of left field, flaming pie. It's just different. It's and it's got the Beatle connection. And, you know, I'm not ashamed to admit this album's come off the back of the anthology, as I say. Yeah. So any of those connections, I'm quite comfortable with.
The title, Flaming Pie, is based on a story. John actually wrote a little article in the local paper called Merseybeat, where he said... When I was 12, I had a vision, and a man came unto me on a flaming pie, and he said, "You shall be the Beatles," with an A. But when we came in the anthology to answering the question of who thought of the name the Beatles, me and George said, well, it was John and Stu. So we had to fudge the issue a little bit, just for the sake of compromise. But so Flaming Pie became a little bit of a joke for us, you know, that anyone could take it seriously. So I made up a song on this new album, and then it's the title song on it, and it's... It's a little bit of parody on the whole idea of a flaming pie.
First met Linda and I, she said, "I didn't know you played like heavy guitar like this," because I'd have an amp and an electric guitar at home around about the time when I was doing McCartney. I'd be sitting around just doing this kind of funky stuff. She said, I didn't have you figured for that. You know, she didn't know me that yeah. well personally. And then I could see the world tonight. A few people I think like it's a little bit rockier,
yeah.
a little bit tougher, the backing and stuff, you know, which is nice. Got that little guitar riff. It's good fun doing that.
I saw you sitting at the center of a circle.
Heaven on a Sunday was the most recent of all the songs on the album. It was just written shortly before we were finishing it all. It was on holiday. And when I go on holiday, I like to sail. And not a big boat, just a little American sunfish called. And they're just, it's a single person, it's just me, the sail, and the wind.
Peaceful, like heaven on a Sunday. Not thinking what to do. We've been calling it love, but it's a dream we're going through. And if I only had one love, yours would be the one I choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I choose. Restful, like heaven on a Monday. song, but it's a long and lonely blues. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose.
In the middle of it, what you normally would do is repeat the chords that you've got going for the song and then do a solo over those chords. And then I thought it'd be a nice idea to play with my son James, because he's getting really good on guitar. For me, I mean, I was very proud. I mean, that's the thing, you know, just as a dad, it's just brilliant to be playing with your kid.
It's peaceful, like heaven on a Sunday. Wishful, not thinking what to do. It's a dream we're going through, and if I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose. If I only had one love, yours would be the one I'd choose.
That's it. We don't need no more.
That sounded good.
All right, Jeff?
Good. Great.
Rocking.
Lost Beatles film. But it's us doing a little photo session. And Lynn took some stuff. Nobody ever knew this existed. So this is really cool. That's quite nice. Standing against John's big, I think it was John's big white roller. And that was before he had it done. Say they suddenly said they found this roll. I said, wait a minute, what's this? We haven't got this logged anywhere. Well, it says Beatles on it or something, you know. So then they said, right, develop it up, let's see what we've got.
I was on holiday, I got a phone call from a friend telling us that a very close friend of our family, who we'd known for a long time, had died. And so it was a real shock to me and Lynn and the kids, and obviously that day we were very saddened by the news.
So that afternoon, as my wont, I was going to go write a song, so I couldn't think of anything else really. And I just thought, well, it would be nice to do a song with this mood, convey this mood, but also for the kids, so that I could kind of somehow convey how much I thought of you. So that was it, and I came up with Little Willow.
Bend, little willow, wind's gonna blow you hot and cold tonight. Life as it happens, nobody warns you, willow, hold on tight. Nothing's gonna shake your love, take your love away. No one's out to break your heart, it only seems that way. Hey, sleep, little willow, peace. is gonna follow. Time will heal your wounds. Grow to the heavens now and forever. Always came too soon. Nothing's gonna shake your love, take your love away. No one's out to break your heart, it only seems that way. Hey, bend, little willow, wind's gonna blow you hard and cold tonight. Life as it happens, nobody warns you. Willow, hold on tight.
For the next episode of Ubu Jubu on the next single.
Ubu Jubu is what I say. A little bit of Ubu Jubu in the night and the daytime never did anyone any harm. Listen, would you like to come around my studio? This is a Wings Mellotron, and these were the original synthesizers. I must say, when we first saw them come in, we never thought we'd get them past the Musicians' Union. We thought somebody would be ringing up saying, oh, that's taking musicians' jobs. Because it was, you know, like synthesizers have since. But EMI had one, and we used to record there. So, again, you know, it was available to us. So, probably the most famous thing we ever did on it, one of the first uses we ever put, was flutes on the front of Strawberry Fields. And I played a little sort of thing on the front of John's song there. That really gave it like a distinctive character. I think I've still got the flutes up on here. So this is something I did for the anthology folks, you know, when they came around. But this is like, I think this is the original flutes, something like this. Let me take you down. And then you go, whoa. You do something like, I've done a lot of the drumming on the new album. As I say, because having drummed for... This will be loud, watch out. So having drummed for years, since the old Lord Woodbine days, and sometimes I'd stand in, like in Hamburg, for Tony Sheridan didn't have a drummer, and I'd just have to play it. Anything I really can't do is shuffles. They're difficult to do, that's just the coordination I can't... But I can do more if it's just a straight sort of rock and... Like a bird needs a break. A bird needs a break? What are you talking about? And your mind is racing, you know. I want your heart, baby. Yeah. Dropping on a plate. This is my very first amp I ever had, actually. When I was 14, I had this little amp called an El Pico. And it's, as you can see, it's very 50s. It's the design, you know. It looks like a piece of 50s furniture, you know. But here it's got... Instead of putting guitars into it, it says mic one, mic two, gramophone, anything but guitars, really. And for instance, in, I think it's Penny Lane, we said, the fireman rushes in.
and we just use that just for him rushing in, you know. Or at the other end of the mallet, this is three bars of office lighting, basically, only coloured pink. But there they go, as you can hear me switching them on. And they've appeared in glorious technicolour. And this was it. This was EMI's nod to psychedelic lighting. Elvis will have been standing just about there somewhere. Bill Black backing him up. Well, since my baby left me, I find a place to dwell. It's down at the end of Lonely Street. It's Heartbreak Hotel. It's a lonely baby. You'll be so lonely. You'll be so lonely. Good night. So that for me is a very special piece of wood. Yeah, that's the Elvis Presley bass. You know, round about those days, it's also sort of a little bit sleazy, a little bit cabaret, but you get stuff like this. I love the sound. Ooh, come on, baby. Can I buy you a drink?
Oh, all right. Where are you from then?
I'm with the government.
All right. I'll have a gin in it.
Well, come on, baby, my little darling. Want a drink with me? Come on, honey, maybe we'll go back to my flat, my flat.
I'll go on and twist my arm. Yeah!
It's back, yeah. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. You see, you can have acres of fun on these things. Oh, boy, I tell you. You see what I mean about the sleaziness of it all? I love it.
Ah, France! Welcome to the castle. Quite a windy night out here. But, you know, I always love it here, in Hirschwick von Schlechtheim.
Who's this Hans character? I've never heard of him.
Don't worry, my darling. We're all together.
Woo! You can have a lot of fun on these things, oh, I'll tell you. Not just me, a lot of young people, too, are looking for this equipment now. I mean, I know Lenny Craddock. He uses it.
Kravitz!
I knew I got that wrong. Lenny Craddock.
Oh, never mind. He calls me Paul McCarthy.
Oh, I wish there was some people out here to keep me company. It's so hard in the woods on your own. Still, never mind. At the moment, I'm working on a new project with Jeff Dunbar, who also did the animation for Rupert. I do most of the voices myself. We can't afford any big-time names. It's called Tropic Island Hum. And the nice thing about it is that we're doing it in the old style of cartoon making, frame by frame instead of on the computer.
Cheers, Sam. You seem very good.
Yeah, I never, you know, it's a musical kind of thing.
Welcome to our island. Glad you came to call. Now you've made yourself at home. You're welcome to us all.
We are simple people. Why are we this way? This is why.
Lovely. So you're going to stick that on a tape,
yeah.
And then I can take that away, and me and Link can have a look at it,
yeah.
Before you go to full colour, yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. Because
lovely.
We've got to, you know,
move
all the drawings. Well, they're upstairs still doing the masks, which is.
Shall we go and have a look?
Right, yeah, yeah, see, that's a duff one. Now that's corrected there. That's beautiful.
Yeah. Ooh,
just
lovely,
easing
yeah.
along there.
Yeah,
see,
giraffe,
the
real giraffe there, yeah.
Why are we this way? This is what we always say. It's the way that we bongo the bongo. It's the way that we bang the big bass drum. The way that we sing the songo. Bass drop, beat, island hum.
Yeah, it's a big improvement on this sequence, isn't
oh.
it? Because we were always, that was one of the big problems
with
the headache.
Very
I think that trick of yours to the decision to pull it down to three.
Yes.
Because we had, what, about 10 of them leaping around, didn't
yeah.
they? None of them had any personality
yeah.
at all.
Yeah. So it's kind of a process of finding your mistakes, you know, each time, and then correcting it, finding it again, correcting it.
Then you just kind of overlay those on the old drawings, do you?
In most cases, we're doing it again.
Yeah.
Now, you see, the bags are really look terrible there. So what we're doing is dovetailing them in, putting more shadow on them, just gently easing it in.
I think, you know, we did think at one point that was a little too tough, that line, you imagine someone wanted to kill that lovely creature and eat it. I don't think it is too tough. I think for this island, I think, you know, I sort of quite like the, I like the way we're being a little bit uncompromising.
Can you imagine someone wanted to kill that lovely creature and eat it? All right, Frogo. All right, Wirral. I know what you mean.
Right, don't come and see us, Alex. No. Are you coming?
No, you don't have to.
I'm staying
after. You don't have to. Yeah. We'll see you. That was lovely, thanks.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye. It's the way that the bag of the mongrel.
It's the way that the bag of the big fish love the way that the singer's song go.
Yeah. The other thing is I've got a shitload of requests here, interview requests from like all around the world. I mean like the Times and bloody New York Times, the Q, Brazil,
France, Italy, Spain,
Congo Basin, I mean you name it, and they want you.
I'd like it just one sort of maybe in each country kind of thing, you know. That'd be nice for me. So you know, you always go that way with everyone wants every single cover of every single magazine. You get yourself in these terrible political things of so-and-so won't give you the cover unless they can see you on the bog. Yeah. Or whatever, you know. So, I think just let's play it real nice and easy, nice and gentle. Don't sweat it, you know, as we've said all along on this album.
No sweat.
Yeah, the other thing, Paul, the last thing was like the launch of the documentary.
Looking at that, there's that to be the launch of the album.
Rather than doing a separate thing. I don't know where you fancy on that or whatever, but somebody was saying,
maybe that should be in New York.
Yeah, it wasn't me. That wasn't me, mate.
Yeah, better here.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think
of it being a quite simple affair, really. Instead of some hugely complex thing that gives us all bad dreams at night. Let us have a laugh, and let us not sweat, and let us put an album out. End of story. All right, Jeffrey, I'll see you around. Thanks a lot.
He's just a young boy looking for a way to find love. It isn't easy, nothing you can say.
Young Boy in America, that's the only track that's, I think, that's recorded out of the studio. So I called up a couple of mates. First of all, called up Steve Miller. And I say, Steve's great to work with, and I knew he was very comfortable to work with, and we admire each other. Always a big help. I love his guitar playing, you know.
Kids and me and John were wandering around with guitars slung over our shoulders. If you just ever said that, like, it'd be a National Trust house. I mean, the idea is still fairly laughable, I tell you. Because it's a little terraced house, you know. In that area, John and I showed my dad the final version of She Loves You. So this had a lot of memories. I wrote, like, When I'm 64, the tune to that when I was 15 or 16 or something.
Thank you.
I was asked by the Liverpool Orchestra to help them celebrate their 150th anniversary. They asked me to do something, so I did the Liverpool Oratorio for that, which was quite a departure, you know, a big stretch. I enjoyed that so much that after it, I thought, well, I could now just write another, but I thought, no, I'll wait for a commission. It's so much better if someone says, hey, would you do so-and-so for us? Because then you almost don't feel to blame them. So I think, well, he asked me, you know, what can I do, you know? I'd just written this probably hour-long thing for the London Symphony Orchestra. It's called Standing Stone. That's been on this. And, you know, it's for a big choir as well, so you can see how the choir's going to sound. Big chappies. More big chappies. Little lassies.
This is a good question. This is from James Gregory in New Orleans, Louisiana.
Yep.
What is your favorite song you have written since leaving the Beatles and Wings?
It's always difficult, you know, to have a favorite, but maybe I'm amazed. Let me just make a short answer. Yeah, maybe I'm amazed. Maybe, you know.
What about since?
I like that one.
I'm Greg from London. Great trainers, by the way.
Hi, Greg. Thank you.
I just wanted to ask you, of the kind of newest generation of artists and musicians, who inspires you creatively in 1997?
Most of the newer artists I know through my kids, not through me buying them, just through hearing them play them, you know. So I like Beck. I like some of his stuff, you know. There's a band called Paw, who, like, I think they're a snowboarding band that I've heard a little bit of. I like Oasis, you know. I mean, it's always a loaded question, that, you know, but about Oasis. But I do like them. I think they sing good. I think they play well. And, you know, if they're going to be derivative, then it might as well be something I'm connected with. You know, it's a tribute.
Okay, let's go to another question from a man in the street.
Hi, Paul. I wanted to ask you what your favorite song that you ever wrote was, both solo and for the Beatles.
Well, that was a great guy on the street.
Yeah, boy. Well, you know, Paul, every fan has their own opinion on what's the best Beatles song, and they all say, oh, this one's the best, this one's the best, I like this one the best. We found an American Paul McCartney fan who really wanted to be on the show and talk about his opinions. Can we roll the tape of that guy, please?
I just thought they were so... They were full of energy, but they were also brilliant. I mean, you go back and listen to Sgt. Pepper's album today. They were brilliant. I still think Eleanor Rigby is one of the most powerful songs I ever heard. I mean, they were just brilliant.
Woo!
You've got a lot of busy kids, actually.
Yeah, I got four kids. James is still in college, and he's looking maybe to do music. He's, you know, he would like to get into music. My daughter, Heather, is a potter. She just had a big exhibition in New York and in London.
The youngest cast member of Let It Be.
Yeah, that's Heather. Right. Yeah, that was her. Yeah.
Those who saw the movie.
Little baby she was then. And then my daughter Stella has just got a big job with Chloe in Paris. She's head of the fashion group there, so she's the head designer. She's doing great, working hard. You know, she's got a lot to do there. And my other daughter Mary is into photography like her mum, and she also is into films, and mainly photography, but a little bit of film. In fact, she and her boyfriend Alistair put together a video.
Did they?
So yeah. Act surprised, John. Act surprised. It's...
Really?
Yeah.
Who knew?
Yeah, well, you know what? He directed it, she produced it, and I believe it might just be coming up.
I saw you sitting at the center of a circle. Everybody wanted something. See you.
I'm Susan from New York City.
Hi, Susan from New York City.
And one of the reasons...
Paul from Liverpool.
Really? There was one thing that you could change about our world today. What would it be?
One thing, violence. Get rid of all the violence and everyone go veggie and be into animal rights and we'll just be okay.
And Paul, I believe this, set it straight, is this the Bishop's Gate, as mentioned in Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite?
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's presumably the poster that was taken off, you know, Pablo Fanke's fur, was somewhere around here.
The celebrated Mr. K performs his feat on Saturday at Bishop's Gate.
At Bishop's Gate, on Saturday, too. What a coincidence!
Is that why you wanted the venue?
Nope. Yeah, that's... I actually happened to be visiting a choir that was rehearsing here for something else I'm doing. And the VH1 people were looking around for a town hall. I said, well, I know one. And it's in Bishopsgate. So, in fact, I'll tell you what, have you got a minute for a mad idea?
You know what, Paul?
Are you ready for a mad idea?
I'm glad you brought that up.
Live. Hey, John. So here you go, here's where we drive the sound men mad. You've got to sing a bit, okay, audience?
Yeah.
I was sitting in my dressing room just before, and I thought, well, I'd be mad if I could come up with some little song about Bishopsgate, all right? And now it'll be really mad if I can remember it. Yeah. But what your bit is, sound man, all you've got to do is... You've got to do... Come on back, come on back. Okay.
Come on back, come on back.
That's it. So remember, that's your bit. Okay. I'll try and remember the song now. Yeah, okay. Oh, now, baby, now the Bishop's Gate ain't what it used to be. He came over from America and he put it on the TV. Well, now they say that they're coming back, and I can hardly wait. Come on back, come on back, back to the Bishop's Gate.
Come on back,
back to the Bishop's Gate. Now you one time.
Come on back,
back to the Bishop's Gate. something like a knighthood? No way. The mere idea of it was so unthinkable. We would have just assumed it was a joke. No doubt about it. It would just be an impossible dream. You just wouldn't even think about it. And it's like, it's a giggle, you know. But it is nice, you know, because you get to make your girlfriend a lady kind of thing. And it's, although she was anyway.
April the 21st, 1990, Paul McCartney stood on the stage of the Maracana Stadium in Rio de Janeiro in front of 180,000 people, and the audience rose as a single voice to welcome a hero to South America. It was the biggest stadium attendance in history, an official world record.
Asked me that about 20 years ago, you know, will you ever tour again? And it's been so long, and I was just said, well, you know, probably, maybe, I don't know. Having quite recently just been around the world twice on two big tours, and, you know, getting that world record in Brazil for 184,000 people or something. It did occur to me that I've got a nice home that I've built for myself to live in, and there's a nice telly there, you can get the fire going, and whoa, it isn't half good. And that starts to attract you, you know, when you're stuck in some Holiday Inn in the middle of somewhere. Start to think, well, you know, what is all this for? You know, surely it's for having a kip and a rest at some point. So that's attractive at the moment. But who knows, you know, I like playing. I like playing to people. The album's finishing with Beautiful Night, which is quite big, and then there's Ringo sort of, all right, come on your way. And we'll put an orchestra on that tomorrow. So that's going to be a big song, I think. It's going to be a big sound. So I think it could be good at the end of that, when that's died down, rather than leaving the album there, just come out with this little acoustic. And that was another of these I was talking about that I remembered. It's actually written millions of years ago. That's this great day. Something Linda and I used to do when the kids were very little. So that's got a nice feel for me. It's very, very simple. But I think I'll pull that back onto the album. I think it'd be a nice little finisher. Beautiful night, great day.
While you wide awake, say it for goodness sake, it's gonna be a great day.
Thank you. you have room in your life for your life?
No, definitely not. That's a funny one, yeah. No, sometimes you do sort of think there isn't enough time in a day, you know, to fit in all the little things you'd want to do. But I have a pretty good go at it, I must admit. But I like working, you know. A lot of people out of a job, you know, and who'd want a job. So I'm always grateful to be in work, you know. So I like working. I like the teamwork. I like working a problem out with people, with other people. That's, I like the friendship of that. And when you come through and when something works, it's a really good feeling. But I like my time off too, because it's a balance, you know. So I like to kind of do things like going in the woods and just hanging, making paths in the woods, because then it's just me and that's my life. That's just me doing something I want to do that I don't have to do, really. So I try and balance it up, really. Somebody said to me recently, said, "Oh, I see you still enjoy your music then." And it hadn't occurred to me that anyone would think I could ever go off it. And I'd had a song called Beautiful Night, which I wrote quite a long time ago, right, quite a few years ago. And I'd always liked it, and people who'd heard it had liked it. But I never felt it was the right version of it. I just felt I just hadn't quite pulled it off. Someone's gone out fishing. Someone's high and dry. Where am I? I'm not going to hurt you. The lyrics had got a bit boaty. They'd all, some boats on the ocean, some about fishing, and they'd all gone about kind of fishing, and there was tackle all over the place, you know. So I thought, right, well, that's all right for one line or one verse. So I cleaned it up a little bit, and I was happy with it then. And he came along, and I said, okay, let's see how we go. So it was really nice. We sat down, I sat on the piano, he just started. So it was really like old days.
Some boat's gone out fishing. Some boats are dry, some boats are littered, till they'll all be alive. Some boats are the vision of the castles in the sky. I'm the left stranded, one wandering wild. You and me together, one can never feel so good. Even if we get a bit old,
I'll give it right back to you.
Yes, you're a bastard.
And you just gone too far.
Okay, that's what? It. So here's a quid. Go treat yourself what? And come back here tomorrow.
So we take both these takes.
I'll leave that to you guys, okay?
Okay.
Right, lovely. And I'll see you tomorrow.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right, you're free.
Yep, I am.
Right. Cut to Abbey Road.
Hiya.
Hello, George.
Hiya.
Nice winter.
Where are we, number one?
Yes.
Closed session, though, we can't go. Shit. Oh, it's us. You can't come in. Oh, now this is more like it. This is what I like to see.
We're
grumbling.
We're not whirling.
Now, don't you start.
How are you doing?
How's it going? Very well.
Okay.
Nice to see you.
Had to happen, on it, and of course we're only hearing the drums quietish at the moment. The times is in a proper mix. It's not enough to fuss about.
Just that little line at the end, I feel it needs to come out a tiny bit. It might get a little bit lost. You know, if you're going to do that, then I think on when the horns do that, I think he's going bam. I think if we could get that together, it might work. Well, I think it's an interesting idea to try and get that sort of whoop, whoop, whoop. But they'll have to work a little bit on it, yeah.
We're recording?
Oh, everyone's healthy today.
And here we have Lucy Martin in a lovely creation by Versace. Donatella, of course.
Thank you.
The only thing I'm requesting is a tiny thing is where the jump that comes in very good. Mm. And then when it doubles, jump, it's a little bit, it's not quite as tight. Sounds like a record to me.
Someone's gone out fishing. Someone's high and dry. Someone's on a mission to the lonely Lorelei. Some folks got a vision of a castle in the sky. And I'm left stranded, wondering why. Nothing feels so good. Even if I get a medal from a local neighborhood, I won't need a castle. They've got castles in Versailles. And I'm still stranded, wondering why. room seems to me the perfect way to spend an afternoon. We can look for castles, pretty castles in the sky. No more wondering, wondering why. Things can go wrong, things can go right, things can go bump in the dead of the night. So let me be there, let me be there, let me be there.
I thought I told you lot to...